Hey guys, this is Karan here. I live in Saudi Arabia studying 10th grade in Yanbu International School. I've done a lot of tutorials on every other subject at only the website of www.youtube.com/modikaran. Today in this section we'll study about or discuss about reptiles. Now there are a type of animals, okay, as we all know. But what is that thing that differentiates the reptiles from other categories of animals is what we are basically going to talk about. And their functions. So here we'll involve some pictures, some videos on it, and a lot of stuff that includes reptiles in it. So let's start off our section knowing what is a reptile and how is it being differentiated from other different groups, right? So, what does reptile basically mean? Well, reptiles, they are type of animals that are ectotherms that are covered with dry scales or plates and reproduce by laying amniotic egg covered with a tough outer shell. Now, notice that I've underlined dry scales or plates and reproduce by laying amniotic egg and tough outer shell. Because these things are not included in other categories of animals. So these things are unique in reptiles, such as snake, for example. The snake, lizards, they have this, they are reptiles, they're in a group category of reptiles, and they have this uniqueness in them that they carry around them, that has dry scales or plates. Like if you haven't seen a snake, it has dry scales on his body, right? So reptiles, basically, how do they produce the egg? Well, they produce amniotic egg. Now what is the egg does that makes the embryonic reptile that is being developed inside the egg, which is fully grown before it can hatch. So this egg are basically developed in two possible ways. Well, in humans, if you see, there's only one way of reproduction, right? You cannot be reproduced from other gender other than female, right? So, but in reptile, there's two possible ways the amniotic egg can be laid or offspring can be produced. So here we'll be also talking about two types of reproduction forms, that is, two possible ways that reptile can lay its egg in order to bring out its offspring. So the first way is by oviparous. The procedure is oviparous, and the second is viviparous. Okay, now, not making it any confusing, but oviparous is something that is independent development of eggs inside the nest. Okay, so like birds, well, birds are not reptiles, but like birds, reptiles lay their eggs in the nest they make. So this is basically independent. Now, what do you mean independent? Development. And basically this is basically opposite, which is dependent . Now let's go ahead and discuss about it. Well, oviparous is basically something that would be in the procedure itself. If you were the reptile, what you would do is basically when you hatch your egg, when you take the egg out and you place it in the nest, but you don't stay near it. The egg basically grows by itself, which is independent. The egg is being independent by itself. And the viviparous procedure is similar, except the reptile stays next to the egg because it's dependent procedure. Okay? This is all the two possible ways the eggs are being can be developed. So the reptiles that you see nowadays, like right around your house, like lizards in your house, then you may see reptiles even outside the house. But when you see them they're completely different than what the reptiles actually looked like before. And it's not only because something happened to it, it's because of the evolution that took place. So because evolution took place in around 250 million years ago, and because of that, the reptiles, the animal that they, the way that they looked, and because of the evolution that happened, the animals that are reptiles now are completely different. Now, if you were to take an example, we would say the turtles that you see have oddly shaped and carry their home at their back. I mean, how odd that is. Because of this reason, their shapes and sizes are diverse and completely different than what it used to be like before. So you may see, first with even the first when evolution didn't happen, all the reptiles, you can basically differentiate them. But if you were to see, like, let's say turtle is a reptile and lizard is a reptile, they're so much different, you cannot differentiate if you have no knowledge about reptiles. Okay, you cannot differentiate that these two animals are in the same category, but they have one quality in common that they share in common. They are reptiles, and they are all exotherms, which basically mean that they change their body temperature as the surrounding temperature. The only reason they are different because of their because they have been evolving for millions of years, which we said it's 250 million ago. So now, over the period of time, amniotics has evolved into three different groups. This discovery is based on temporal holes that are found the side of the skull, okay? And they're based on that. So now, like we mentioned, that there are quite a lot of changes that took place that has occurred in the modern reptile, like the oddly shaped turtle, like we give an example for. We can basically form up our four examples of reptile and talk about them. So here, we'll be talking about the reptiles, which is oddly shaped, and if you guessed it's a turtle, you're correct. So we'll first start off our talk with the reptile about turtles. And even though most people get confused when they hear turtle, the word turtle and tortoise, and they cannot differentiate between them, because they think even if you say tortoise or say turtle, they are basically the same animal. Even though you may say that they are the same animal, partially you're correct. Okay, so you understand why half of you're not correct. Let's go ahead and talk about turtles. Turtles, tortoise, and terrapins are the only remaining anapsid group of amniotes. The shape of the turtle is actually a bony shell that encases the reptile's body. Now here, we'll erase this. And because we are talking about turtle, we'll list all the differentiation between these three categories, including turtles and tortoise. So here we're talking about turtles, tortoise, terrapins. Okay, now the shape of the turtle is actually a bony shell that encases the reptile's body. Now it has a dome back of the turtle, which is a serapace, while the smooth ventricle part is called plastron. Why is it so important, people might ask? Well, it's basically because the shell is covered with tough, flattened plates made up of keratin. And like we said, keratin is a skin layer which has proteins that doesn't make the skin dry when you have water in them. And they're basically used for reptiles, and whenever a reptile moves from one region to another region, basically mostly because of whenever they go to a dry region, they don't want their eggs to be hatched before the embryo is developed, because then it might just die. So they have this keratin protecting skin around them that are fused to turtle's rib cage and vertebrae backbone. So in turtles, they have dome back. Okay? Notice this. They have dome back. Now these turtles are basically toothless and have sharp horny beaks. They are omnivorous, which basically means that they eat meat and plants. So there are a number of places they can be found in, such as terrestrial, freshwater, like an ocean or a river. Now these are differentiations between them, because those turtles who are found in terrestrial areas are known as tortoises. Also, they have high dome shell, while those who live in freshwater have flattened shell and have species that have lost the bone in their shell to become soft shell turtle. What do I mean by this? In turtle, you have dome back. Even in tortoise, you have dome back. But this dome back is very high. Okay? It's very high dome back. While in here, you have flattened almost like this. And the reason is because this type of turtles, okay, let's draw some eggs, right? Legs right here. Okay, they live in water, fresh water. While these people live in terrestrial. Areas. So they need to have a high dome back, and you can relate this by having how they basically differentiate between them. For example, if this turtle, which has flattened dome back, were to live in terrestrial areas, you know it wouldn't survive. So because of the survival, because of the evolution, they have formed this high dome back, which helped them survive in terrestrial areas, and also because to protect it from their predators. Now we will talk about our second category. After we have talked about turtles and tortoises, we'll talk about snakes and lizards. Now the reason I'm pairing, you could understand the reason why I paired tortoise and turtles, because they have the same, almost everything is same, except they live in different environment and have different structure of the body. Well, in this, snakes and lizards, we'll be talking about same structure, okay? They have different structure, but in the front they have same structure is what I meant. And the function of the same is completely different. So, snakes and lizards are very closely related and share a number of features. Snakes and lizards all shell their skin at regular intervals. Basically, they shield off their skins, and we quite don't know about lizards, because the person who doesn't know anything about lizard might not know. But if he knows that a snake can peel off its skin in regular interval, but so does a lizard. They also have flexible skulls that let them capture and swallow their prey. Then their head. All snakes and lizards use a highly developed organ that allows them to taste the air. Like we have shown, a snake has this tongue. Whenever it's taking its tongue out, like regularly, you might seem that it's ready to bite someone. It's actually not doing that. The function of that tongue is basically to taste the environment. And because of that tongue, because the snakes can't see, they can taste the environment, and because they have lived with that tongue their entire life, they have developed a technique that because of that tongue, they can sense that this environment is good for them, not harmful for them. Okay, so this is how the the snake, the tongue of the lizard basically works as well. So whenever you see a snake or lizard flicking out their tongue, it's basically collecting the particles out of the air. And particles that are interpreted by sensory receptors, which are called Jackson organ, which basically is the top, found in the top of the reptile's mouth. What this organ does is basically allows lizards and snakes to locate predators and to locate prey and avoid predators. Now, most lizards are carnivores, which basically mean that they only eat animals, not plants. So some species hunt down insects, but large species such as Komodo dragon prey on mammals. Some species such as iguanas are strict herbivores. They do not eat meat, they only eat plants. But snakes are the group of legless lizards. All snakes are predators, like we know. Some snakes kill their predator by constriction, wrapping their body around their prey and squeezing it like anaconda. Whenever they swallow a human or a big animal, what they do is they have this tree. Okay, whenever they swallow, they wrap around the tree and they crush the animal or the human inside their stomach and swallow them. Okay, so this is it about snakes and lizards. Now, what we are going to do is basically saw an exercise. So what is the snake doing when it's flicking its forked tongue? You know, whenever, you can see the question over here. Now, you know, whenever the snake is flicking out its tongue, like we mentioned, is basically sensing the location of predators and prey. How do herbivorous reptiles and vivipar reptiles differ? Well, basically, embryos of viviparous reptile develop completely independent of the adult. Viviparous is, like we said, oviparous, and there was viviparous. Oviparous was independent, while this viviparous was dependent. So yeah, guys, like, comment, and subscribe. Thank you for watching.